Good afternoon. Let me try it once again. Good afternoon. Wow, not bad. How many of you are thinking about this? Be honest, come on. Good. Yep, even I am thinking about that, by the way. So it's time for lunch. So I know I'm standing in between your lunch and this particular session. So let us all focus for next 30 minutes on this particular diagram. Okay. So what is this diagram? So this is microservices. And this is a microservice dependency graph of Uber. Okay, so this is this much complicated it can get when you try to build microservices at scale. And if you don't have right set of tools to handle these microservices, it will be very difficult for you guys to figure out what your code is doing. So I've added some of the disclaimers because Jaeger or whatever we are going to discuss today is having lot of intricacies because it is having dev and ops both involved in it. Okay, so my first disclaimer is that I don't want to talk about any of the architectures. Because this architecture is available over internet, and you can go through it. And also, I'll be giving that reference at the end of my slides. Phrasing, is actually implemented by developers. So this is how many developers are here. Perfect. Cool. So phrasing is implemented by developers, but my talk is not going to be from developer perspective. So my talk is going to be from the ops perspective. So the developers implement it, and ops and dev both consume this particular tool. Okay. The another disclaimer is that we have an open mind while listening to this discussion, because I don't think that I'm talking about five services, but have an open mind that there are more than 50 services which is interacting, and we are building praise for that. Okay, and another disclaimer I want to add is that Anand, don't ask questions for me. Okay, that's out of the work. Okay, this is me. I'm a developer advocate at DigitalOcean, and I was heading DevOps at Blackbuck, and I was working with HCL as well as a developer. Solution architect for big data projects, and was part of IBM India Software Labs for over 8 years. So let us discuss what is microservices, at least the most important thing about distributed system, right? So let's take an example. Okay, we are building a marketplace or an e-commerce site, and we have certain services. Let me show you the product, order, cart, messaging, account. I've only taken five services as an example, but there could be more than 30 more services involved at the back end. There could be inventory, there could be catalog, there could be merchant management system. So there's a hell lot of things at the back end, right? So all these services are decoupled. Why do I say it is decoupled? Because it has databases separately, right? So any code push to your product will not affect the order system. And any code push to order will not affect the cart system, right? So that's how it is decoupled, unless and until these guys are interacting with each other, right? Unless and until there is an interaction and there is a failure, and we also had a talk in the morning on how to handle those failures and all those stuff, right? So, of course, these know, microservices are interacting with each other with various set of queues in between, message brokers and other stuff. I don't want to get into the architectures, building of those architectures. So just assume that you have more than 20 to 30 different services interacting with each other. And let's take an example. If there is interaction, then let's take an example that your user is trying to access a billing. He's accessing his billing or a cart or something from your application, the e-commerce site which you have built. So when he's trying to access, there is a latency. Okay, there is a latency, there is a, you know, there is a performance issue for that user. When there is a latency issue, what happens to your application? The user will leave your application, right? You'll not try to use it anymore. They think that it's pretty slow, let's move on, right? So that's what the user mentality is. So there is a latency issue, there is a latency in your application. Now, what are the today's solution? How do you solve this problem today? So first option, what you will do is you'll go and figure out logs. You take the logs and you check the logs. But there are services, right? More than 30 services. There's a lot of logs. And looking into the logs is obviously, it's pretty painful, when you're looking into many logs between different services, it's pretty difficult to correlate and sometimes it does not make sense. And, the most of the critical parts are not logged at all. I don't blame developers, but, they don't usually log most of the things, right? So, yeah, what about metrics? So, you have metrics, but metrics will give you that something happened at the time. There is some issue happened at the time, and there are 20 different services in between, and there is obviously a issue with that metrics again. So, you'll not be able to find the right set of information. You can't debug the request which you're getting. So this has been the problem when you're thinking in a large scale and each request, there's a latency problem involved and developer is not able to debug, right? So the more the number of services, the complexity is more, right? So as service A talk to service B, and service B talk to service D, and it also creates another child called service E, and there is again, till you take this till X, Y, Z. It is pretty complicated when all these services are creating logs, all these services are creating, interacting with each other, and there is absolutely no way to figure out what happened to your request. Where did it all touched, right? So microservices and new problems. So these problems are already there, but microservices will complicate the problem, right? So what is the problem? Root cause analysis. So let's take one more example. You have a merchant who goes and updates his, the product information and product pricing. Once he updates that, what happens to that? It actually publishes that particular information to the catalog, right? The catalog again publishes to Elastic so that user can search based on that price or whatever the product, etc. So basically, how do you figure out, there is a touch points between different services, the service A, service B, service C, service D, and how do you follow the path of that particular request, a single request I'm talking about. And again, transaction monitoring. So microservices have different databases, and there is transaction with on these databases. There is a commit which is happening, right? So this the commit has to happen from the the backwards, because the last commit has to tell, okay, this commit is fine, and then it goes to the previous one and then say, I got the last commit information and I need to commit this one. So there's a transaction monitoring of a particular request is not available in logs or in your metrics, right? And service dependency, you know, the dependency between different services is not available. So I showed you the first slide where, you know, there was dependency graph which I was showing you. It's pretty difficult to figure out what are the, you know, dependencies between the microservices. And of course, the, to improve the performance of your application, to improve the, you know, optimize the latency, you need to know what's happening in a particular request. This is the most important thing of microservices. In what context a request is talking to different microservices? The context is the most important thing, right? So if I am accessing, you know, buying or selling, and there's a transaction which is happening, and this context is to transact selling. This context is to transact buying. So this is the information is not available in logs unless and until the developer is actually coding, and also the, you know, different correlation. There is no correlation between the service touch points. So to solve this problem, you know, what happened was people came up with phrasing. Okay, so log analysis we still do. We don't do away with it, and we don't do away with monitoring as well. But phrasing is something which is you know, they brought in to manage a particular request, to you know, to see what happens in a particular request. Okay, so all these people started designing their own phrasing, and you know, from Google to Twitter, who else? Google has two. Yeah, so all these people started designing their own phrasing, and Zipkin became more popular, but it had problems. But all these things were based on three core steps. They were tracking code, and they were storing the data. So basically, they were storing what was happening in the code, what your code was doing when a request comes in, and they all had what to query, what not to query, and the display for a UI to query the, you know, the request. But that did not solve the problem, right? That the microservice is, again, it's not just you. It's not just you're talking to your own services, right? You're talking to services which is external to you, right? So a Book My Show talks to PVR service, right? API service, right? So so everyone started designing it, but it did not solve it. And also you can see logging, metrics, and tracing had overlapping parts, because even tracing was doing logging. Even you know, metrics was you know, logging something, and logging anyways logs. But you had different systems. There was no core, you know, interoperability. Okay. Then there is obviously when there were so many vendors involved, they were actually you know, building different services, and one service was on Zipkin, one service was on something else. They were not able to share data, right? They cannot share data between them. So there is obviously, there is no logging standard when they are not able to share data. So what happened? So CNCF got together, they brought in something called as open phrasing, and this is nothing but standardizing the APIs. So basically, everybody can talk to each other if they implement these APIs. Okay. One of the key information open tracing brings in is for a particular request, from where it is coming, for a particular request, where it is going, and some references and type of request. That is nothing but the context, right? The type which is required. So, I just want to bring in some, you know, a kind of context related stuff. So you have your service, you have API you have designed, and you have implemented open phrasing, and you have shared libraries. So you're sharing data in a particular context with not your service. So basically, if it is not your service within your organization as well, there will be a lot of different services which want to share data. So using the open tracing standards, you can actually share the data and also define context. So we will see in the demo the context, the things which we can do. So what is Jaeger? Jaeger is a monitoring tool which is built on the API standards. Okay. What are the three things it does is it will actually give information for you guys on what is your code doing and what are those patterns. Basically, it's just to figure out at what context the interaction is happening, at where there is a bottleneck, and where there is your MySQL query is held up, where there is lock issues are there. So basically, it gives you a complete pattern, and it actually traces one component to another component. So basically, you can actually trace the complete interaction between of a particular request from service A to service Z. Let's take an example here. Okay, so this is a bad picture, right? So this is an e-commerce site, and you browse or you do some stuff, and it actually goes to service A, service B, service D, and then there is a commit happening in database. Okay, so service A, when it comes to service A, it is actually storing the information of the transaction, and service B, service C, all information is stored, and this is where the Jaeger comes into picture. It has a UI and a database. You can actually query, and you can actually do you can get more information of the transaction which is happening. So some of the concepts. A trace is a collection of spans. Okay, this is the concept of open standards. Open tracing and Jaeger. So a trace is a collection of span. What is a span? So basically, you have a request. That request will create a span for a particular microservice A, and then that is one span, and then there is a service B, there is another span, then there is a service D, service C, service F, then there is a span of chain of span gets created for a particular request. Okay, so collection of all these span forms a trace. And some of the properties a particular span has is operation name and start and end time and tags. Tags is nothing but searchable key value pair, logs and baggages and references. Baggages is a metadata type and all those stuff, and references is tailed off and follows from, etc. So let's take an example. You have a request to check your bills, and user comes and he says, I want to access all the bills. And when that happens, there is a span created. So these are the spans, and this is the authorization microservice. So once the authorization provides information to billing, how does it provide information? It provides information via baggage or via tags. So and it also logs, of course. So it provides information to billing, and billing calls various other spans, and there is a lot of it can call n number of spans, and then script could run, and the information is provided to the user. But notice that it's over a period of time. So everything is timed, and everything is collected in the time series database, and it is available via Prometheus, and you can use it any time series database. So let me do a live demo. I hope it works. So I have, let's see. So you can see there is a command which I'm running, which is it's just creating the Jaeger Docker. It is like all in one, but I told you that I'm not going to talk about the architecture. It has a lot of architecture like Elastic, or you can use Cassandra for storing this data and all those stuff. So you should check out the website for that. Let me do this. Also notice the command. So basically, I just want to give a kind of understanding there. There is a UDP, right? UDP port, right? So basically what Jaeger does is it just sends the information. The code which is packaged, the Jaeger client, it just sends the information, but will not wait for a response from the Jaeger client, okay? Let me. Go to. So this is not an Uber app, okay? So basically, this is how it has been built: is that you have a web client where Redis is there, it is giving you a session ID, and there are a few set of kind of microservices and backend have been used to do this demo. There is some MySQL kind of a simulation and all those stuff. So this is something like we are all in rootconf and we have to get back home. We need to book a kind of cab. So let's do this. So when you click on this, yes, I told you, I'm pretty brave. Oh, I got one car. Cool. So this is now pushed to the Jaeger client. So Jaeger client is this. I hope you guys can see this. Okay, some information on Jaeger client. There is dependencies. This is the graph which we were actually seeing when I showed you the first slide of Uber. Since this is pretty, we have very less microservices, it is pretty small. We'll see a directed graph. I have a front end, it is making so many calls to Redis, and it is making some calls to customers. Some failed, we did not get a car at all. So some failed as well. So we'll go back to this. So here you all the services which is available is, you can check it out. And let's run. Okay, so there were 9 trays created. So basically, I clicked 9 times, and only one got through. Rest of them failed. So if I click this, this is how your trays looks like. So there was a front end call. It called to a customer. It called to again customer, and there was some issue in MySQL, and if you go there, you know, for acquiring lock, it was waiting for acquiring lock, right? So and there is some tags which you can create. It also shows you what command SQL query it is running, and you can see a lot of stuff. This is where it is also showing what is the execution time and all those stuff. Let me go back. So you can see there are failures are here, right? If you see this part, you can see the failures here, and there are some requests which went through, which went through a few of the services, but it failed to provide required information. So only one got through, which is here, right? So let me show you how it will look. So this is basically the trace. So if you see, it created a lot of trace, one after the other. So you can actually figure out from here that there is Redis, something happened in Redis, and there was a session timeout and all these things for the particular driver, so it could not provide the driver at all. So you can actually figure out for a particular request. So that is the magic of tracing. You can go to the level of single request. So with one request, you can actually trace a touch point of so many microservices, which I showed you in the first slide, right? So coming back to this first one, this is the first one, right? So first one will actually show you the complete history. So you can see the complete history here, what is actually happening. This is an algorithm which is running in the backend. It is actually calling the root to figure out the root. It is actually seeing which driver is available and all those stuff. So there is a simple, I'll share you the repository as well, so you guys can go back and check it out. So there was only one car which was provided. Let me go back to search, and you can use driver equal to. This is how you can query for a particular request, and you're actually, if you see, you can actually write a lot of log search code here, HTTP status and all the stuff, and you can also see an RBAC and other stuff. Let me stop here, and let me go back and give you guys some references so that you guys can play around with it and learn a lot of stuff. Repo, architecture, framework, and concepts and terminology is available here, so you guys can go back and learn. That's me. If you have any questions, we can discuss. Oh, I think we have a question. Okay.
Cool. Any questions? Yeah, over here.
Hi Vivek.
Yep.
So if I have an existing application consisting of microservices, what would it take for me to add this distributed tracing tool into it? And what is the minimum thing that I need to add so I can enable this?
Yep. I did not touch upon that because it was more from the developer oriented, so I wanted to keep it more ops. But if you want to do that, right? So it's a standard, right? So basically, you have to index, first you will have to initialize your code for these libraries to be used. And then you will have to use that standards and create those baggages and other stuff. But as it says, right, microservice is complicated. When you try to implement that, will take some time for you to actually implement this because it is from the developer perspective, right? Developer has to sit and code, refactor his code when he is trying to put the distributed systems with this phrasing, which is already existing once. So if you're building from ground up, or if you're building something new, then this is pretty easy to implement. If you go, you can check out the repos and other stuff. The code is pretty simple. You can actually initialize and just use the, those libraries and start using it. Again, if you're using microservice, you will have a small team as well. So the small team of developers, and if it is pretty small applications, if you're made sure that your microservice is it's not too heavy, then you can easily implement it because it's not going to take much of the code as well. If it is very small.